Good morning and welcome to the 12th meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee. The committee is currently conducting an inquiry on the UK internal market. The aim of the inquiry is to consider the implications of the UK internal market for Scotland, including how devolution will work going forward. So our first agenda item is a panel on... We are on two panels this morning. Our first panel this morning, we will hear from Seamus Leahy, Northern Ireland Policy Manager, Logistics UK, and Billy Mello-Arroju, Senior Lecturer, School of Law at Queen's University, Belfast. And can I welcome everyone to the meeting this morning. We are going to move straight to questions, and I wonder if I've got an opening question for each of you, if that's okay. Mr. Mello-Arroju, if I begin with your paper, you state that even if Scotland continues to align with the EU law, that it will not remove regulatory barriers faced by Scottish businesses exporting to Northern Ireland. Can you explain to the committee what this would mean for competitiveness of Scottish businesses wishing to trade in Northern Ireland?
Yes, hello, good morning. As I understand it, Scotland, the Scottish Government, has this policy that it wants to maintain alignment with EU law to the greatest possible extent. And so the point I was making in my evidence is that you can replicate all the EU legislation and you can interpret it and apply it in the way that it's interpreted and applied by the European Court of Justice, but that will not remove the need to demonstrate that you comply with EU law when you are trading with EU, when you're exporting goods to the EU. And of course, that would also apply to Northern Ireland, the goods sold to Northern Ireland, to the extent that Northern Ireland remains subject to the EU customs and regulatory regime. So far as things stand, since we're at the early stages of the post-Brexit period, there's very limited regulatory divergence between GB and Northern Ireland, GB and the rest and European Union. There's a very good paper that's written by one of my colleagues here at Queen's, Lisa Claire Whitton, where she was able to show that so far actually that there have been no real substantive amendments to EU law that's listed in the annexes of the protocol. Most of the changes have been technical in nature or cosmetic in nature. But of course, as time goes by, regulatory divergence is inevitable to the extent that Northern Ireland is tied into the EU regulatory framework. And the greater the regulatory divergence, it is, in theory, theoretically, the greater the competitive advantage Northern Ireland will have, purely because of this dual market it has, thanks to the combined application of the market access principles of the Internal Market Act and the protocol, right? So under the protocol, Northern Irish goods get this unrestricted market access to the EU single market, which has hundreds of millions of consumers with unparalleled purchasing power, but also Northern Irish goods are able to have unrestricted market access, or at least benefit from the market access principles under the Internal Market Act, even though they may be subject to completely different rules to the rest of GB. I'm happy to provide some examples just to illustrate how that would work, but I'm mindful not to spend too much time talking.
We can maybe come back to that. I don't want to take up the whole time. If I could move to a question to Mr. Leahy. In your paper, you state that the UK food produce is now treated as a third country status when entering into the single market, and this has created a huge burden on GP exporters. Can you expand on what the impact, in your view, has been on food producers in Scotland?
Hi, good morning. The impact here is that any food exporters in Scotland or anywhere in GB, they have to comply with sanitary and phytosanitary legislation to export those goods, whether it's to Northern Ireland or to anywhere in the EU. Now, that could be seafood, it could be dairy produce, it could be bread. So that means you need export health certificates. At the moment, we have a grace period for chilled meats that can come into Northern Ireland still. So things like a sausage roll, that can still enter Northern Ireland. Technically, it shouldn't, but we have a grace period for that at the moment. But there's quite a lot of paperwork that requires veterinary sign-off and also the pre-notifications with the DEFRA system for arriving into Northern Ireland as well. We have our environmental agency here is DERA, and they're responsible for controlling the port of SPS products, like food produce, into the three ports here in Northern Ireland. So that requires full checking of all paperwork, and then for a certain percentage of those goods coming into Northern Ireland, that may require also a physical inspection. At the moment, because of third country status, you would normally see, without an agreement on food alignment, you could have checks up to maybe 30% of goods coming in. Now, that's unfeasible at the moment for the number of lorries that arrive in to Northern Ireland daily. We're probably talking around about 1,200 lorries a day arrive into Northern Ireland, and about half of those come in from Scotland at the port of Cairn Ryan. It wouldn't be feasible to have that number of checks right now. Checks are probably down around about the 5% level, but we definitely need some type of agreement on those coming in at the end of the grace periods, because I think we would struggle to comply with that. So in conclusion, really, there's a lot more paperwork, and obviously with the administration and staffing costs that takes for those exporters.
Thank you. I'm going to move to questions with Getty. Bring in Dr. Allen, please.
Thank you, Convener. I'm interested to hear Mr. Lahinney about, you mentioned trade with Scotland there. I'm interested also to know what the impacts of the current situation and any changes to that situation would be, you know, through Protocol 16 and withdrawal and all the rest of it. I'm just interested to know about the trade you have with the Republic of Ireland and how that fits into this jigsaw.
Yeah, I think probably if we look at trade, first of all, we can see, because with the protocol, there's the positives and the negative consequences at the moment. Trade with Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland has been very healthy this year. We have the statistics from the Central Statistics Office in the Republic of Ireland. That shows that Northern Ireland exports for the first 6 months of this year grew by 77%. That was an increase of nearly 800 million euros of new business. A lot of that new business going to the Republic of Ireland was probably Southern Irish businesses sourcing goods that they may have sourced from elsewhere in the UK prior to the 1st of January of this year. We've also seen a 43% increase in imports from the Republic of Ireland into Northern Ireland as well in the first 6 months of this year. So there's definitely that has shown the benefit of that dual market access with the single market for Northern Ireland. Unfortunately, the Office of National Statistics don't have the stats yet for trade between GB and Northern Ireland yet. However, exports remain steady from Northern Ireland to GB. There's no barriers in that at the moment. It's difficult to say what impact we've got on goods coming from GB to Northern Ireland without those official statistics. What I would say is that freight volumes through the port of Cairn Ryan in Scotland, which goes to Northern Ireland, for the first 6 months of this year are up 16.9%. So Cairn Ryan has seen quite an increase on freight volume going through the port. Now, that could be down to healthy imports coming from GB to Northern Ireland. What I would say is that we do have a lot more hauliers avoiding the port of Dublin and Holyhead, and they're coming through Cairn Ryan instead, because at the moment we do have grace periods for goods coming into Northern Ireland. If you're moving goods into Dublin, it's full third country status. It may as well be Calais where you're sending the goods to. So Dublin has actually seen there's a decrease at the moment of 21% on volumes. But the worst hit of all has been the port of Holyhead in Wales. They've seen their freight volumes fall by 33.3% because they relied on that traffic from Holyhead to Dublin. So that shows what has actually happened. A lot of freight traffic that used to move between GB and Northern Ireland, the fastest route to market, if you're wanting to get to London or even to continental Europe, was via Holyhead, Dublin. A lot of hauliers are now avoiding that route and have now moved north to either Belfast, Liverpool, or Belfast, Larne and Cairn Ryan.
As an industry, are you, without asking anything that's commercially confidential, are you having to make contingency plans around what might happen if Article 16 is triggered?
It's something as an industry, the industry, no one in the industry wants Article 16. We see that as more disruption. It would create certainly a lot more lack of stability and clarity for businesses in the long term. And it would call into question the trade we have with the EU. I suppose what Article 16 does at the moment, if you have a barrier from east to west, so a trade barrier from Great Britain to Northern Ireland, that primarily that affects the consumer, because 75% of the freight that arrives into Northern Ireland on the ferries from Scotland is destined for retail. It could be new cars, it could be yogurt, it could be clothing, it could be anything. So that affects the consumer. However, our trade between Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland, 70% of the freight that moves across the border is what we class as intermediate products. So it's ingredients and components. So if you put a trade barrier, which Article 16 could do, that then puts pressure on manufacturers and exporters in Northern Ireland. So it's kind of a lose-lose scenario that we have. At the moment, we're focused on making sure there's a negotiated outcome between the EU and the UK. We want Article 16 to be avoided at all costs, and we want the protocol to work. The protocol certainly isn't perfect. We've said basically since January 2020, before its implementation, that it wasn't perfect. It needed refinement and it needed mitigations agreed between the EU and the UK. And we, along with other business organisations, we engaged quite heavily with the European Commission as well as the UK government on reaching those agreed mitigations.
And finally, Mr. Arujo, we've heard their one view about Article 16. Would it be fair to say that there are mixed expectations about that issue in Northern Ireland, and are you able to say anything about the range of opinion that would exist about that and about the prospect of Article 16 being triggered? Public opinion is what I'm thinking of here.
Yeah, well, I should clarify that I'm a law scholar, so I'm not really, and I'm also Portuguese, so I'm not sure I'm particularly qualified to speak about political preferences and opinions here in Northern Ireland, and I'm not sure I would want to either. That said, it's a very interesting question, because right now at Queen's that we have an ESRC-funded project, Brexit Governance, focusing on the application of the protocol, and you may have seen a news item on this. There was some polling that was recently produced by Queen's on this issue, which showed that, largely speaking, Northern Ireland electorate was not particularly in favour of triggering of Article 16, for very much the reasons that Mr. Laney was outlining in the previous question, in his previous answers. In terms of, you know, what Article 16 would entail and what the potential retaliatory measures would be, I don't know if that was part of your question, but again, that's happening.
Certainly, I'm happy to that would be of interest to you, yeah.
Yeah. So I think that there's a lot of misconception in terms of the media coverage about what Article 16 entails in practice. And quite often you'll find a lot of conversations about the suspension of the entirety of the protocol, or major components, the entire trade component of the protocol. And that's not reflective, that's not an accurate representation of what Article 16. Article 16 is about suspending certain obligations under the protocol, subject to certain the fulfillment of certain conditions. In terms of what the suspension could be, they are limited. They are limited in their scope, in that they can only be justified insofar as they're intended to address a specific issue. It should be the least trade restrictive or the least restrictive measure possible, and the one that least disturbs the functioning of the protocol. So we're not talking about full-blown suspension of the protocol or even whole swathes of the, you know, trade-related obligations of the protocol. We're talking about very targeted measures. And of course, they have to be justified, and you have to show that either there is evidence of trade diversion. I am aware that there's anecdotal evidence that this is happening, but that's not the same thing as actual evidence that the protocol is leading to trade diversion. Or you have to show that the protocol has somehow led to difficulties of a serious economic, environmental, or social nature. And it's always important to remember that there is a good faith requirement enshrined in the withdrawal agreement, which means that you cannot use Article 16 of the protocol as a pretext to avoid your obligations under the withdrawal agreement. The reasons for the suspension of the protocol have to be genuine. And so it's unlikely that a minor trade diversion, which can somehow be linked to the protocol, would fall under the scope of Article 16. Now, in terms of what happens if the UK triggers Article 16 of the protocol, there's a whole procedure in place. First thing to note is that the UK cannot trigger Article 16 from one day to the next. It first has to notify the EU its intention to do so. And then that triggers a one-month consultation period. And it's only after that one-month period that, if they're not able to reach some sort of resolution agreement, that the UK will be able to suspend a part of the protocol. The EU then has the option to take rebalancing measures. Again, those rebalancing measures are not automatic. They're subject to a consultation period. And again, they're limited in terms of what they would cover. They have to be limited to what is strictly necessary. They have to be applied in a proportionate manner. There are other options. So, for example, if the EU thinks that the UK has unlawfully triggered Article 16, it could initiate before the dispute settlement mechanism established by the withdrawal agreement. Again, that's something that would take time. You would have consultation period, you'd have the actual arbitration, the possibility of preliminary questions to the European Court of Justice, and then you'd have a ruling which would, if the UK has triggered Article 16 unlawfully, would require the UK to remove that measure. If then the UK doesn't remove that measure within the reasonable period of time, the EU could request this arbitration panel to impose financial sanctions on the UK. And if the UK then does not apply, that does not pay the financial sanctions and does not remedy the situation, then you can resort to retaliatory measures under the TCA, which would essentially mean a reimposition of tariffs on the UK as a whole. But again, these have to be proportionate. The last thing I'll say, and I'm aware that I've been talking for a while now, the last thing I'll say is that there has been talk about the possibility of suspending or terminating the TCA as a whole. So that's an option that's available in the TCA. First option would be to notify the EU, for the EU to notify its intention to suspend or terminate the TCA in its entirety, but that would require a 12-month period notice. The other possibility is to argue that the unlawful triggering of Article 16 of the protocol constitutes a substantial failure by the UK to uphold the rule of law, in which case there would be a one-month notice period for the potential suspension or termination of the TCA. So that would be covered under the essential elements clause. So the wide range of measures that can be put in place, all of them are subject to procedural requirements.
Thank you.
Ms. Boyack.
Thanks very much. Can I ask how people plan ahead, particularly businesses? Several of the respondents we've had to our questions say that we'll have a race to the bottom in terms of standards, but in the paper you sent us, Mr. Arujo, it's clear that both Northern Ireland will align with EU standards and the Scottish Government is committed to keeping pace with EU standards. So can you say a bit about how you think that impacts on the wider UK internal market and how you see alignment with EU regs impacting going forward, given that Northern Ireland is you will have that opportunity, and how do we as parliamentarians have accountability or transparency, given that a Scottish Government and Scottish Parliament are not involved in the transparency process through the meetings that take place between the UK Government and the EU? I realise that's two questions.
Yeah, I'll try and answer the first one, and then maybe you can remind me of the first one. The question on democratic accountability, I think, goes back to another question, which is about the democratic accountability of the protocol and the governance structures that are established there. And there are actually a lot of criticisms leveled at the protocol in that regard. So when a new EU act is adopted, which could fall under the scope of the protocol, the procedure is that the EU has to inform the UK in the context of the Joint Committee, which is the main body in charge of implementing the protocol. But really, most of the work happens lower down in the Joint Consultative Working Group, which is a body composed of EU and UK representatives. And this is where the real technical discussions on rules actually happen. And this applies to both proposals to amend legislation that's already covered by the protocol and new acts, or new EU legislative acts. There have been criticism leveled at the operation of this joint consultative working group. First of all, deliberations are confidential. There are questions concerning the extent to which Northern Ireland representatives were involved or not. In particular, stakeholders, which were not involved in any shape, in any way or form, which is very problematic when you're developing regulation, right? You need technical expertise to shape the decision-making process. And some of these concerns have been, the EU has tried to address them in the recent proposals, the non-papers, which you may have seen. So the EU's proposed lifting confidentiality, creating structural dialogues, which include Northern Irish stakeholders, but strengthening ties between the Northern Ireland Assembly and the European Parliament. But still, we're some way off the decision-making, the influence that other third countries, which pursue dynamic regulatory alignment with the EU, for example, the EEA states, were some way off their level of input and influence in the decision-making process. So, for example, they have the right to be informed in terms of any planned new EU legislation. They have an observer status in relevant European Commission committees, comitology committees. There is an obligation on the European Commission to consult with experts, technical experts from the EEA, in the same way that it consults with the EU. So there's a world of difference there. And so then to go back to your question, how can you bridge that gap in terms of having Scotland having some sort of influence in the decision-making process in order to give a veneer of democratic legitimacy? It's difficult to see how you achieve that, given that Northern Ireland, which is subject under the protocol to these laws, has already a very limited influence. There are indirect ways you can do that, through diplomacy, by investing in the Scotland's regional offices in Brussels, and through lobbying. But besides that, it would really be about strengthening intergovernmental relations between Scotland and Northern Ireland, which I'm aware are already very good, interparliamentary relationship, and seeing whether in the context of existing cooperative formats, intergovernmental cooperative formats, or perhaps in the context as well of the common frameworks, which are fairly problematic right now, whether there would be an opportunity there to have regular discussions with UK and Northern Ireland representatives who are involved in these discussions.
That's really helpful, thanks. The first bit of my question was about the alignment with EU regulations, which triggered the question about how do you get this transparency. So you've got the alignment with EU regulations in Northern Ireland. Scotland's committed to doing that as well, but there are tensions, which many of the commentators have given us. So how do we monitor what happens in terms of divergence? People have said the standards will go down, but you've got Northern Ireland and Scotland wanting to stay aligned with the EU. So how does that impact on the rest of the UK market, the internal market, that the legislation is aspiring to deliver?
Right. So as far as the Internal Market Act is concerned, in relation to Northern Ireland, it's you have to establish a distinction between two types of trade flows. You have Northern Irish goods which are being sold in GB, for example, in Scotland. They benefit from the Internal Market Act and the market access principle, and they have a fairly unrestricted market access to GB. There are some restrictions, but as the next panel will no doubt discuss, those exceptions are fairly limited. So Northern Ireland, despite the fact that it's subject to the EU regulatory regime, will have a fairly unfettered, unrestricted market access to GB. But then you have goods from GB coming into Northern Ireland, to be quite frank, the Internal Market Act is irrelevant, right? So their regulatory status is defined by the protocol. And because under the protocol, as you already know, Northern Ireland is subject to EU internal market rules and EU customs rules, they will be subject to obstacles to trade, irrespective of whether Scotland diverges or not from EU rules. There will be checks. There will be checks, customs declarations, procedures. There will be regulatory compliance checks, because as I explained before, the fact that you have the same rules does not mean that the regulatory compliance checks doesn't happen. It just means that the regulatory burden on Scottish traders is reduced, because they don't have to comply with two different set of regulations in order to have access to the EU and Northern Ireland market. But they still have to prove that those goods are in compliance with EU rules. And of course, there's the other thing, that there's possibly also the potential application of EU tariffs, where goods coming from Scotland are deemed to be at risk of being moved on to the European Union.
Okay, thank you.
I'm just going to ask Mr. Lahaney if he's got any questions, any comments on those questions, maybe in terms of the uncertainty that this creates.
Very quickly, what businesses here, they just want certainty at the moment. For the past probably 2 years, there's been a lot of uncertainty. We have a lot of foreign direct investment is cautiously waiting to see what happens with the protocol. We did have a major announcement here in Northern Ireland 2 weeks ago with a large multinational business investing something like £200 million, plans to build a new factory in Belfast. And one of the reasons was that for the dual market access, they make tins for the beverage industry. So they said on their statement it would be the ability to export those goods to the rest of the UK and the European market. And we also had a major pharmaceutical company here make an announcement of creating something like 1,000 new jobs in Northern Ireland. And the pharmaceutical industry, what was quite important for them with the Northern Ireland Protocol, if you're a pharmaceutical business in Northern Ireland, you have the ability to sign off medicines that can be sold in both the UK and the European markets, which that business, it's a company called Almac, have said is a major selling point for those. So if we can get more certainty, if we can get the protocol tied down and that agreement, we would hopefully get more announcements like that in the near future.
Thank you. Ms. Minto?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Harold. I think it's a follow-on question to the ones that Ms. Boyack was asking. In Mr. Arujo, in your evidence, you talked about the qualifying goods and possible changes in that had meant to be brought in October 21 but have been delayed. I wonder if you can expand on that a bit, and also Mr. Lahaney, if you've got any comments on that too. Thank you.
Yes. So I previously said that when it comes to Northern Ireland goods that are being moved on to GB, they have an unrestricted market access. But there are limits, and one of these limits is that supposedly only Northern Ireland qualifying goods would benefit from the market access principles. So the UK defined what constitutes a qualifying Northern Ireland qualifying good last year. So hopefully I don't forget. So it's any good that's in free circulation within Northern Ireland, so not subject to any customs control, and any good which is subject to processing in Northern Ireland. You know, essentially any good that's lawfully present in Northern Ireland can be considered to be a qualifying good. The issue with that, of course, is that it means that it's fairly easy for example, rules from the Republic of Ireland, who typically, if they wanted, if they were to be exported to GB, would be subject to the TCA regime, which is far more cumbersome and onerous. You'll have to, for example, comply with rules of origins, and you'll be subject to increased customs checks. It's fairly easy for goods made from goods from the Republic to simply be moved on to to Northern Ireland and be stored there or packaged there and then moved on to GB and piggyback on the protocol. Piggyback on the internal market and benefit from the principle of mutual recognition enshrined in the Internal Market Act. And of course, the UK was aware of this, that this very broad definition of Northern Ireland may lead to certain abuses. But it opted for this very broad definition because just like the grace periods, which are currently in place, and the suspension of customs checks on EU imports, the idea was to minimize trade disruptions resulting from Brexit, from the end of the implementation period, to, you know, to, so that you wouldn't have a very abrupt and sudden shock, and rather that these economic costs would be phased in. But the plan was to tighten up the definition to ensure that only goods that are genuinely have a link with Northern Ireland can benefit from the Internal Market Act. There was also the possibility of Northern Irish goods that were destined for the GB market but were routed via Dublin for them to also be covered by the Internal Market Act. But so far, there's no narrow definition, and there's no explanation from the UK government in terms of how that would work in practice. We were expecting a definition and guidance in October this year, but the UK government said that because of the ongoing protocol negotiations, it was going to wait on that for a while. So it's an issue we have no clarity on. But from a Scotland perspective, there's a potential risk there in that it is possible that goods that are not truly originating from Northern Ireland could access their market through the back door, through the Northern Ireland Protocol and the Internal Market Act, rather than simply being traded under the terms of the TCA.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Ruhu. And Mr. Lahini, I suppose the question ties in with the comments you were making earlier about risk versus a knowledge as to how you're going forward. And I think it also ties in a bit to your point that we were making about the change in routes, no longer Holyhead to Dublin.
Yeah, I think what Billy says there, you know, it covers the point very well, but it also raises a lot of questions. We're talking probably each year there's about 450,000 lorries transit between Northern Ireland and Cairn Ryan in Scotland. We've asked that question, and Billy alluded to it there as well. How do we ensure that Northern Ireland produce that is destined for the GB market, that it has purely unfettered access to the GB market? Because how do you differentiate what is Northern Ireland goods, what is Republic of Ireland goods? So we need that Northern Ireland qualifying. What will be the status to prove that? And that's got some concerns because from the 1st of January, the UK, the border operating model comes into effect. Now, only customs controls will be enforced, first of all. That's relatively straightforward. Where things may become a little bit more complicated will be next summer when the UK then starts to impose its sanitary and phytosanitary controls. So there will be a requirement for the government to have some type of infrastructure at Cairn Ryan or that vicinity to check occasionally loads coming in, because not only do Northern Ireland goods use that port, but you will also have goods from the Republic of Ireland. And then what Billy alluded to is that there is the potential for goods that are not Northern Ireland qualifying, but to be marked as maybe their origin as Northern Ireland. So there's going to have to be some type of responsibility taken by the UK government, by DEFRA, by Border Force, etc., to ensure that, that's not being abused, and that Northern Ireland goods are only, I suppose, taking advantage of that unfettered access.
Okay, thank you.
Ms. Ruskell?
Yeah, thanks. Can I just stay with Mr. Lenny, actually, and ask you about, you know, looking forward, whether you see trade barriers going up across Europe and across Ireland and the UK, or whether you see them going down. You know, we had some evidence which suggested that, for example, there might be the creation of a sort of common veterinary area, which would help with transportation of animals across Europe and you know, and regulations associated with that. And that would be outside of the European Union as well as inside the European Union. What, going forward, where do you see that picture?
Probably for us, yeah, we would like to see greater alignment with obviously the UK and the EU. But, you know, a veterinary agreement would be ideal for us, because it minimises a lot of those SPS controls. To put it in context, New Zealand has a veterinary agreement with the EU, which means New Zealand lamb coming into the European Union is subject to a 1% risk profile. So, you know, for every 100 containers of New Zealand lamb that lands in, one on average is inspected, which is pretty good for them. But that's because New Zealand then has to comply with the standards on that. Really, for us, I suppose it goes back to that question about the TCA between the EU and the UK. Our concerns really regarding Article 16 would be that if it led to maybe the breakdown of the TCA, is that the European Union, it may take the European Union maybe up to 3-4 months to introduce maybe tariff barriers or tariffs on GB goods, UK goods. What would be of concern to us would be the non-tariff barriers that the EU could implement pretty much within a matter of days. That would be things like greater percentage of checks of UK goods arriving into the European Union, and also the requirement for export summary declarations for goods destined for the UK from the EU. At the moment, that's not being enforced, but it could be pretty much enforced at Calais, Zeebrugge, etc., Dublin, in the event of that TCA breaking down. So what all businesses want is just that that agreed outcome, and hopefully over a matter of time, that TCA just becoming a little bit more firmer and a little bit more closely aligned.
Mm-hmm. Do you see there's a political will to remove trade barriers?
I think, you know, speaking to the Commission, certainly there's an appetite there to minimise. We see barriers as just added cost for consumers. Certainly in Northern Ireland, we want minimal barriers, because Northern Ireland consumers have half the discretionary spend as consumers in GB. So, you know, that comes down to the government here, what they wish. If they think that there's trade deals that can be got elsewhere, that where we can get cheaper food, they may think maybe that, you know, raising barriers in other places means cheaper food for consumers. We don't know yet. We ideally just want to see agreements in place that minimises data for administration, for customs and for SPS. If you walk away without any agreement, that just means food produce moving between the UK and the EU, it's treated as third country. It'll be treated like food coming from outside the EU, which has the highest barriers to overcome.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and can also ask about the kind of domestic regulatory agenda as well, which is something that's concerning us, because you've got the protocol on one side, you've got the Internal Market Act on the other. I mean, how is that affecting the discussion of domestic legislation at Stormont? You know, is there a nervousness about innovating? You know, we've had a discussion here in Scotland about banning the sale of peat products, for example. Is there a concern that any kind of innovation coming from Stormont might be seen to be caught between alignment with the EU, but also falling foul potentially of the IMA?
Yeah, I suppose with Northern Ireland goods, they are in free circulation in the single market, so they'll have to adhere to European standards. So there will be the onus on businesses here that when you produce goods in Northern Ireland, that they're licensed for sale, not just in the EU, but the UK as well. So that would be a concern with that dual approval status for the Northern Ireland goods. Transport is fully devolved in Northern Ireland, as is agriculture and environment. So there is things for us, you know, when we're looking at, and I know Scotland is heavily involved and well progressed with its, emissions and clean air strategy. That's something Northern Ireland has to consider with regards to, you know, the change to sustainable fuels on vehicles, etc., because we want to make sure our vehicles can be driven legally in the EU. We've got that land border to comply with. It might be a little bit easier in GB, where, as an island, you know, people typically aren't sending their vehicles into the EU on a regular basis, whereas in Northern Ireland, it's quite common for vehicles to cross the border every day. So that's something, yeah, that we're going to have to just keep pace with European legislation on some things, especially around vehicle standards, emissions, and so on.
I don't know if Mr. Royo has any comments on that.
No, just one thing I would add is that, and it's something I try to explain in my written submission, the situation here in Northern Ireland, as far as the regulatory framework is concerned, is extremely complex. And keeping up with all the amendments and changes, both at UK level and EU level, is going to be extremely difficulty, because you're dealing not just with UK law, you're dealing with retained EU law, you're dealing with devolved legislation, you're dealing with EU law that's currently covered in the protocol that may be added into the protocol. And I think it's a colleague here at Queen's, Professor Katie Hayward, who explained this as, you know, trying to keep, you know, on top of multiple spinning plates. And so, you know, part of the issue is just keeping on top of all these, you know, interconnected regulatory frameworks. And just to go back to something Seamus was saying, in a different context, what they want is clarity and simplicity, right? Because what we have here is a system that's extremely complex, but to add the uncertainty on top of it just makes it makes life for business, but also for the devolved authority here so much more difficult.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Mr. Golden.
Thank you, convener. If we park for a moment what might be acceptable to all parties, what, in your opinion, could be put in place from a legal perspective to improve the Northern Ireland Protocol? To Mr. Arruja.
The video panned off to Seamus. I wasn't sure anymore. It's a very good question. Again, when you look at the polling here in Northern Ireland, it's quite clear that the preferred solutions would be of the type which Seamus already discussed. So, a mutual recognition agreements, veterinary agreements on SPS, perhaps also mutual recognition on batch testing with respect to medicine. These are all solutions that would remove most of the current trade frictions, and they would have the added benefit of simplicity. The problem, of course, is that it would require regulatory alignment from the UK as a whole, which, again, is something, as we know, is not something the current government is particularly keen on. You will have seen the proposals which were published by the European Commission in terms of how to improve the protocol. The way I describe them is that they're very practical proposals, in that they seek to address concerns that have been voiced by industry in Northern Ireland on a consistent basis, whether it be the complexity of the goods at risk regime, the SPS checks, or the difficulty in sourcing medicines from alternative sources of supply, so non-GP sources, supply sources. They are practical in that sense, but they're also limited in that, unlike mutual recognition agreements, they would not remove the need for, they would not remove or obviate trade barriers. And also they come with conditions, right? So whilst they might reduce some of the barriers to trade, they won't, they don't have the benefit of simplicity, and they don't have the benefit of providing truly unrestricted market access.
Thank you. And if we can move on to Seamus Leheny. Just feel free to comment on that question, but I also wanted to ask you a more practical one regarding, is there any technological improvements to allow more frictionless trade that, you know, doesn't involve just no checks? Is there anything, like, whether it be QR coding, open data sharing among logistics firms that might be on the horizon or are maybe already ready to be deployed?
Yeah, that's a good question. There are a couple of logistics businesses are voluntarily trialing some technology at the moment. Now, going back a number of years ago, you might remember the term alternative arrangements. I was on the government's alternative arrangements working group, and there was different ideas floated about how you could potentially make the Irish border work. Unfortunately, a lot of this technology relies on a central processing point for goods to arrive, and that's a port or an airport. So when a lot of these ideas were put forward for the Irish border, where you had several hundred road crossings over a small area, and the technology didn't completely do away with infrastructure along that border. I had a meeting with the Canadian government last week. The US border with Canada, it's around about 8,000 miles territory, but it only has 120 border crossings, and around about 20 of those handle the vast majority of trade, and that's where the technology is used. And the US and Canada has such technological solutions in place. They have a trusted trader scheme for the big movers of freight across that border, and for the movement of parcels and so on and so forth, rather than multiple declarations, one declaration per truck, etc. So that, going back to how we can make that work between GB and Northern Ireland, yes, there are IT systems that can certainly give integrity. And I suppose the key thing is give the European Union confidence that the integrity of the single market is upheld, where they can see goods arriving into Belfast, for example. They can see the origin, the journey, and the final destination. And what we want to do, it's all about minimizing the at-risk profile of goods. What the EU is concerned about is that if 20 tons of beef arrives into Belfast port from Cairn Ryan today, they want to make sure that beef, which could have originated from Brazil or the US under a future UK trade deal, doesn't end up in France the next day. So what we would like to use is use that technology by an approved retailer or a wholesaler, show the final destination that it's for sale, etc., in Northern Ireland. So these proposals have been put forward both to the European Union and also to the UK government. They're aware of such systems, and we would hope that if we get these mitigations, these trusted trader schemes, and certainly Maros Sefcovic has even been quoted as saying the green lane status of goods arriving into Northern Ireland, that technology can play a big part in that.
Thank you, panel. Thank you, convener.
Mr. Cameron.
Thank you very much. Good morning to the panel. My question is for Mr. Leheny again, and you referenced some of this in your earlier comments around the ONS data, which was published earlier this week, which showed indicated that Northern Ireland was outperforming the rest of the UK, and that this may be down to the benefits under the protocol. My question is, do you agree with that? Does it reflect what you're seeing on the ground, or is it simply too early to tell?
I think it's too early to say. A lot was made about that. It could be, you know, it could be where Northern Ireland was starting from a lower point, so we had less ground to make up than other regions, because I've seen a region like the West Midlands took the highest hit on that. But the West Midlands, obviously, prior to pandemic, etc., was performing very strongly, whereas the Northern Ireland economy has always been kind of playing catch-up with a lot of the UK on that. So until we get the trade state stats for the UK, which probably will be published in about January or February time, it's very difficult to see how Northern Ireland is performing in that context, the internal market. Certainly our exports are holding up well, but it's about what's coming in here from the rest of the GB. We just don't have a 100% clear picture on that yet. Certainly that there is certain produce that would traditionally have come in from GB is now harder or restricted to get here, and that has led to some substitution with products on shops in Northern Ireland, where you might have seen particular products, GB products on shelves here. They're now less frequent to see, or you don't see them at all, and instead you may have products either locally produced in Northern Ireland or the Republic of Ireland substituting them. And the stats from the ONS in the new year will give us a clear picture.
In your submission to the committee, you mention the fact that the burdens are falling on GB goods coming into Northern Ireland. And you also say that this will have a knock-on effect in terms of the consumer in Northern Ireland, because added costs will just add to the price of goods. Are you seeing that yet on the ground? Is that having a practical effect?
There's certainly the rate of inflation obviously is affecting everyone at the moment. What we need to see, basically, retailers operate in such fine margins that either if they're going to bring in a product here where there's increased costs because of those SPS controls and customs, either they have to make the decision whether they still stock it but at an increased price, or do they look for an alternative similar product which they can maintain the price point that they have. I'm not seeing anything yet. You'd probably need to hear from the retail sector about those impacts. So it's a bit too soon yet to give a clear answer on that.
Thank you. I'm looking to see if there's further questions. I've got a couple of final questions. Mr. Lahaney, if I could ask you about something you said about the increase in the use of the port at Cairnryan, obviously more freight companies choosing to use that from the GP and the impact that's having elsewhere. I just wanted to ask you about concerns about capacity in that respect. Obviously, neither route from Cairnryan south or north E77 is particularly good at the moment. But also, what are the capacity issues at the port at this point in time? Is that an issue you'd be concerned of?
Probably in Cairnryan, you know, anyone who's familiar with the port, there's a lack of space there, capacity. I know last year the Scottish Government, there was a contingency plan for Castle Kennedy Airfield. Just as I said, Stranraer is a place where vehicles could be stacked, could be checked, etc. When the UK begins inbound full controls in the middle of next year, there would be concerns from industry about the capacity to carry out those checks. So that's something to consider and keep an eye on. We haven't had any notification or information from government yet, whether, you know, from DEFRA or HMRC about the capacity there. The roads, the A75, we've long campaigned for the upgrade of that road. It was good to see in the Union Connectivity Report published last week that the A75 was highlighted. So if there is going to be increased traffic, which we're seeing on that, it would be good to see work on the A75 progress. And then the last point, probably on capacity with the ferries. The ferry companies will certainly say there isn't a capacity issue on Cairnryan, both to Larne and Belfast. Where there is a problem, however, is availability on those peak hour sailings. So because more users are now wanting to use that route, trying to get space on, let's say, you know, an 8 o'clock or 10 o'clock PM sailing from Cairnryan to Northern Ireland is becoming increasingly difficult, and that could have an effect on people, you know, being able to get the sailings they want. And that's what retail requires. They want to get those loads into Northern Ireland late at night, early hours of the morning, to be on the shop shelves the next day. And we don't want to see some type of, you know, the prices going up on those routes, which again will affect the consumers here. So it's about just that balance. So people will say to you that there isn't a capacity issue in the route. I would always drill down and look at the availability on the salings that are key to retail.
Okay, thank you. And if I could ask a final question of Mr. Melo Arrojo. You mentioned about the notice period around the, you know, withdrawing from the TCA, and that I'm just interested in understanding. Obviously, Mr. Leheny earlier on said what business is looking for is stability and certainty about what's happening. But obviously, everything around the proposal to perhaps invoke Article 16 would lead to more uncertainty. But I'm also interested in Ursula von der Leyen saying that the EU has had a ladder of sanctions up to withdrawal from the TCA. I'm just trying to understand if there's any notice period to some of these sanctions that the EU might take, or could businesses find themselves in a matter of days having to respond to changes?
Yeah, I mean, it all depends. It all depends on the type of sanctions that are being considered. So when I was before, I was outlining all the sanctions that are available either under the withdrawal agreement or the TCA. But there are other options. There are more immediate sanctions, which could be, you know, more political moves. So, for example, there's been talk of holding back on adequate decisions on transfer of personal data or blocking UK accession to the Horizon Europe research program, you know, which would all be political moves, which would be outside the context of the TCA or the withdrawal agreement, which could be used to exert pressure on the UK in relation to Article 16. Now, in terms of the sanctions that are covered by the withdrawal agreement and by the protocol, there are all, as I said, there are procedural requirements, and there are usually consultation periods that are required. So none of them are immediate. So, for example, with the nuclear option, which would be the termination of the contract, you have a 12-month notice period. Where you are planning to terminate on the basis of the essential elements clause, you have at the very least a 1-month consultation period. But really, these are the worst case scenarios, and I suspect that they have been put out there in the media conversation in order to give some leverage in the ongoing negotiations to make it clear that it's serious about this. So I mentioned the rebalancing measures, which are would operate under Article 16 again. The rebalancing measures have to be targeted, they have to be specific. We're not talking about major trade barriers. And they could only... And in terms of the retaliatory measures, which would be covered under TCA, you would have an entire dispute settlement mechanism that would be in place. So you need to... You need to trigger that dispute settlement mechanism. You'd need to have a 1-month. You'd have to have two arbitration procedures before you can actually go and adopt retaliatory measures in the shape of increased tariffs on the UK. But none of them are immediate. All of them have deadlines and procedural requirements that have to be fulfilled before they can be applied.
Just to let you know, we had a couple of brief breaks in transmission there, so you may, I think we've got the gist of what you were saying, but you might want to come back and clarify. But I think we're okay in terms of understanding your point. Just a final point, you mentioned some examples, specific examples. I think that's always very helpful to understand. So there's been a lot of talk around the situation for seed potatoes and farmers with seed potatoes in Scotland, and the situation with that, which seems to be in a negotiation stage. I was wondering if you could give us some specific examples of the types of products that may end up as part of this situation with the uncertainty and as things are going forward, things that might happen to other goods. I'm not sure if you are you hearing us? Sorry, that was for Mr. Melo Arroyo. I don't think he's hearing us. I'm really sorry, but I don't think that we're hearing. I think we're probably finished with questions from today. Anyway, can I thank both our witnesses, both for their contribution today and for the helpful briefings to the committee prior to today's meeting. And I'm going to suspend for 5 minutes for a brief break. Thank you. Welcome back to our second panel today. We'll give evidence on the UK internal market. The committee will hear from Professor Joe Hunt, Professor of Law at Cardiff University, Professor Nicola McEwen, Senior Fellow of the UK in a Changing Europe, Professor Stephen Witherell, Emeritus Jacques Delors, Professor of European Law at Oxford University, and Professor Witherell will be a bit late onboarding, perhaps. Oh, he's here. He's here. Thanks. So we've got everybody this morning. I'm going to move straight to questions again. An opening question for Professor Witherell. In your paper, you state that the EU's internal market is designed to favour the claims of local regulatory autonomy over the claims of unimpeded trade significantly more than is the UK's internal market. Professor Hunt and McEwen's papers state that whereas devolution prioritised political autonomy and the ability to do things differently, the UK Internal Market Act prioritises unfettered market access. And I just wonder if you want to comment further on that.
Yeah, I think we're all saying the same thing. We're all telling the same story. Any internal market is based on a fundamental problem, which is that constituent elements within the internal market might regulate trade differently. And insofar as they do regulate trade differently, that leads to obstacles to trade within that internal market. So there needs to be a way to manage that tension between unimpeded trade and regulatory autonomy exercised by the constituent elements within the internal market. And the way that all internal markets manage that tension is to put regulatory choices taken by constituent elements to the test. Is there a value in the local regulatory initiative which is sufficiently strong as to override the interest in unimpeded trade in goods and services between the constituent elements of the internal market? So putting those constituent elements' rules to the test is the heart of internal market law. So what is important is determining what factors can be advanced to justify local rules, even in circumstances where they obstruct cross-border trade within the internal market. And the core is that the European Union is more generous in accepting possible justification for local rules which obstruct trade than is the UK. So the EU internal market is more generous to local regulatory autonomy and more restrictive of trade within its internal market than is the UK's internal market.
Can I ask Professor Hunt and then Professor McEwen to comment, please? Thank you.
Just to reiterate Professor Witherell's points there, we have a system that has written across certain elements of the EU approach, but has done so in quite an idiosyncratic way, and a way that views the Internal Market Act, sort of views devolution and the potential for divergence as an obstacle, as a potential sort of irritant to the economic integration which is within the United Kingdom, which is prioritised and privileged through the market access principles within the Internal Market Act. Now, we have something similar within the EU system in terms of the free movement market access principles, but they come with a much more developed set of grounds for justification for why local choices might be able to be sustained within a wider market. And so there's been some right across of the EU rules, but not a full right across of those. And we see with the Internal Market Act, it comes from a different starting point to the common frameworks in terms of how they see managing divergence and devolution. They take different approaches to the devolution settlement.
Professor McEwen?
I agree with everything that the others has said already. I don't want to repeat that. I think perhaps understanding the Internal Market Act in the UK and it's as an ideological project in a sense. So it's the same sort of ideological drivers that Initially, when we had these debates around devolution, we're sceptical about the effects of devolution creating divergences, creating barriers within the United Kingdom, and we're seeing the same thing here. So I think it is privileging unfettered access for businesses across the UK as a value in and of itself, over the value of regulatory autonomy and the potential divergence that emerges from that. One thing I would add, which is another difference between the UK internal market and the EU internal market, is that within the EU context, the rules and the regulations are co-determined by the EU institutions and by the member states. And clearly that hasn't been the case in with respect to the UK Internal Market Act. It's been determined, of course, by the UK legislature, which has representatives from across the UK, but it was in the face, as you will be well aware, of the considerable opposition from the devolved institutions who will stand to be most affected by it.
Thank you. I'm going to move to questions from the committee, and I'm going to bring in Dr. Allen first.
Thank you very much. Question for Professor McEwen. Firstly, last time round we heard in committee about how trade may be reserved, but the impact of policy in this area is felt in devolved areas. Looking at the road ahead, what areas of devolved policy do you think might we have to prepare for change in?
From trade agreements?
From trade agreements,
external trade agreements, or just generally? I suppose it depends on how extensive they are. I mean, in the case of the TCA, because it was such a minimal trade agreement, it has some repercussions for devolved areas, but actually not that many. It depends on how ambitious and how broad future trade agreements will be. But again, following on from the point I was making there, in other countries, perhaps with more federal systems, you tend to have the territorial governments, provincial governments, whatever, involved to some degree in the preparations and in the negotiations and discussing the mandate for trade negotiations, not least so that when trade agreements are reached and when they may be implemented, that there is awareness of how that might affect their own responsibilities. I don't think we have that to the same extent in the UK. There are intergovernmental forums, but I'm not sure how much of a voice the devolved institutions have in those. It's one of the issues of lack of transparency around a lot of these forums and negotiations.
Thank you. And if I can change tack back to the subject raised in the last panel, this might be one for Professor McEwen or for Professor Wetherill, possibly, about the implications of Article 16 potentially being invoked I'm thinking here, if you like, the diplomatic implications, how unusual this would be regarded in terms of the UK's relationship politically with the European Union and what that might mean.
I think I'll leave that to the others.
Okay, in that case, Professor Wetherill.
Make one or two brief comments. You've had a very good run through the content and the implications of Article 16 in the previous panel, and I claim no expertise with regard to the sensitivities that arise in Northern Ireland, but I can't see that anybody feels that any good can come from the invocation of Article 16. It adds greater uncertainty to a position which is already extremely uncertain. I very strongly underline what you've already heard in the first panel, that Article 16 is no general fix-it to the problems which are raised by the protocol. It's much more narrowly written than that. It's also written in a way which is ambiguous. It's far from clear what, for example, the diversion of trade criterion to its invocation entail. So Article 16 is a way to add further confusion on top of a protocol which is already beset by confusion. And you heard very powerfully in the first panel about the damage that is doing to business confidence.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Ms. Boyack.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'm very keen to ask about, to follow up the questions on divergence and accountability, and want to thank the witnesses for their briefings in advance. Professor Wetherill, yourself and others have given us submissions identifying pressures from the UK internal market to lower standards, but other evidence we've had suggests that divergence could actually have a positive impact. For example, the Institute for Government suggested it could enable a testing of effectiveness of policy implementation, evaluate success and collaborative learning, and FIDRA talked about the potential environmental benefits of divergence. So could you give us a sense of what you think the space is for devolved governments to apply policy change within their competence? You've said it's limited, and what do you think the scope is to resolve any disagreements on these issues going forward? Thank you.
Yeah, I'm sure that Nicola and Joel want to say something about this as well. I mean, in principle, it's a very attractive idea that you can have regulatory experimentation, regulatory learning, regulatory emulation within an internal market. If you allow different constituent elements to do different things, maybe one constituent element will find the best way to solve a particular problem, and that understanding of the best way to solve a particular problem can be shared directly or indirectly with the other constituent elements, and they may follow suit. So you may get a regulatory dynamic, even independently of agreements struck between the constituent elements. The problem with the UK Internal Market Act is that if one constituent element chooses to experiment in its regulations by introducing stricter rules to products, let's say, than apply elsewhere, then those stricter standards are undermined by imports from another constituent element within the UK, which do not need to comply with the stricter rules of the experimenting constituent element, unless those rules happen to fall in one of the very small areas where justification is allowed for local rules under the United Kingdom Internal Market Act. So there is a dynamic within the UK internal market which is antagonistic to regulatory learning, because the constituent element that chooses the stricter rules may find them undermined by imports from another part of the United Kingdom where producers do not need to comply with the stricter rules, either on their own territory or on the territory of the constituent element, which is the regulatory experimenter and to which those goods are exported.
So that takes me very much to the second part of my question to you, is what is the scope for those disagreements to be resolved? You could think of something like changes on climate policy, which are not necessarily experimental, but are definitely good practice. Where's the scope for devolved and UK government interaction to resolve those issues?
Yeah, Joe and Nicola should speak. They know more than me about this, and I've been talking too much. But the common frameworks approach was understood to be the way in which that sort of political mediation could be pursued. But all the sense in the passage of the bill and subsequently is that the government in London has a far less enthusiasm for the common frameworks approach to solving these sorts of problems within the UK internal market than one might initially have expected and hoped for.
Thank you very much. I was indeed intending to follow up this question with other witnesses. Professor McEwen, I was hoping to come to you next just to follow on. You also suggested in your submission that there would be benefits to divergence. And one of the things you highlighted was the difference between production of goods and use of goods. And that potentially would relate to public procurement or planning requirements. Could you say a little bit more about that and pick up the issues that you've mentioned about accountability, whether it's intergovernmental and interparliamentary transparency, something emphasised by many of the other respondents we've had.
Okay, so just for clarification, first of all, the evidence that I submitted was along with Professor Hunt and others as well. Professor Dugan and Professor McHarg are not with us today, so Joe may want to come in on this as well. Just on the principles of divergence, I don't think any of us are in disagreement, including the other submissions that you made reference to. There are lots of potential benefits to divergence in principle. The point is that the Internal Market Act and the scope of the market access principles, while they don't prevent regulatory divergence, they potentially prevent it having the same effect that it might have had in terms of achieving the policy goals were that legislation not in place. And so that potentially then has a knock-on impact on the scope for learning, the scope for experimentation, the scope for seeing if something works, as we have had so far in the case of devolution. Where there is scope for permitting divergence to occur in ways that are void of these restrictions is through the frameworks process, and in particular that additional element that came into the Internal Market Act towards the end of its passage, where there is scope for common framework agreements to be excluded from those market access commitments. Now, my understanding is that the governments have been working towards an agreement on how that will happen. And so the tests coming up will be around single-use plastics, for example, or the deposit and return scheme. If these can be agreed within a common frameworks process, the resources framework, which is not yet in the public domain, will that allow for these particular policies to then be exempt from the Internal Market Act and the market access principles, so as to allow divergence and the policies having effects throughout the territory, not just to producers within Scotland? So I think these are the real tests that are on the horizon, so we get a better sense of quite how limiting and constraining the Act is, or whether the Common Frameworks Agreement process can be married with it finally in a way that still permits the kinds of divergence that some may want to see.
Thanks very much. So we're still waiting to find out whether it actually will be the capacity for divergence. You also mentioned in your evidence the need for more, not just intergovernmental transparency, but also interparliamentary transparency, and you've made a few recommendations. Do you want to say a bit about why you think, or what those recommendations are that we should be actually following as a committee?
I think there's lots of different things here. So first of all, with respect to the frameworks, I mean, clearly some of the frameworks are going to be really important quite quickly, and the resources and waste framework, I think it's called, is one of those. Now, I don't know if you have seen it, but it's certainly not published even as a provisional framework just now. But making sure that you as parliamentarians have early access to these, and access, I suppose, to the kinds of negotiations that would potentially lead to common framework agreements, potentially then being exempt from the Internal Market. We just don't know how that's going to work. And it does seem that there's an awful lot of executive authority given within the Act to the Secretary of State. And this all seems to me to be in the sort of political executive domain, which makes it difficult for parliaments to scrutinise effectively. There's other things within the Act that empower the Secretary of State to make changes to the scope of the Act after consulting, but not necessarily heeding on what they hear, but after consulting with devolved ministers. But there's no carved out role for Parliament within that. So that's something perhaps that you could agree with the Scottish Government, that when they are part of a consultation process, that Parliament is very quickly also part of that consultation process. But it's a very short timeframe of around a month in some cases for that process to take place. So it's really tight, and it's going to be difficult for Parliament to get a voice. My suggestion was, in terms of engaging with the other legislatures across the UK, because they will all be doing much the same as yourselves. There was some interparliamentary engagement and networking around the Brexit process and Brexit negotiations. I think some of that, it would be good to see that being re-energised as we're looking at perhaps the domestic effects of Brexit, as the internal market legislation and frameworks process might be seen as that. So connecting with those other parliamentary committees to enhance the limited capacity that you all have for scrutiny and collectively perhaps to boost that.
That's very useful. And can I
bring in, can I just say, Professor McEwen, just to let you know that the Interparliamentary Forum is meeting, first meeting next Thursday, and Deputy Convener and myself will be attending in London. Sorry, it's for information. Thank you.
That's very useful information, Convener. Thank you. Professor Hunt, I wondered if you would comment as well about the action that's needed. Very much welcome the submission that you were part of, but we also had a submission from Scottish Environment Link, which raised the importance of parliamentary scrutiny, and they raised the issue of the importance of the accountability, for example, of the Office for Internal Market in Scotland. And just again to come back to the question I asked Professor McEwen about parliamentary scrutiny, given timescales are tight, but how we deliver both better intergovernmental relations but also scrutiny from interparliamentary liaison work. Could you say a little bit more about that in terms of your submission?
Absolutely. And speaking from here in Wales, where we have particularly acute sort of capacity issues affecting our own parliament and a need to expand, be able to effectively engage with the increasing amount of work that's going to be coming down the line to be scrutinising, holding to account the actions of those that are operating under these frameworks. Now, we look at the common frameworks. One of the issues, we know that there's certain phases within that supposed five-step process of making these frameworks. There was some telescoping of those frameworks, of those processes. We're now supposedly at stage four for most of them, so they're shared with parliaments and with other stakeholders. But there are reports that engagement process to date has been more limited than perhaps would have been ideal. And of course, when parliaments are engaging with these frameworks, they're not looking at sort of final decisions, policy decisions on particular issues. It's the framework for managing decision making. And so it's ensuring that there are steps built into how those frameworks work that enable the ongoing oversight and engagement of parliaments within that process. So it's not that the framework itself is a done deal and that provides an answer, and a final output on a particular policy issue, but it's an ongoing, living constitutional document. So there's the challenges there of building into that. Also, in terms of the work, if we then move to the Internal Market Act and the Office of the Internal Market that's been set up under that Act, in terms of the reporting that the office will be undertaking, and we know that there will be regular reporting on the state of the internal market, it's less clear. I don't know if the others have more insight in this than I do, in terms of those requests for information, for guidance that legislators might make to the office, whether that sort of intelligence is then shared more broadly, or whether, in terms of reviewing whether particular policy choices might throw up problems from an internal market perspective, whether those reports are going to be more generally shared and transparent, or whether there's going to be, that's a closed process. I'm not clear on that, but throughout the entire system, whether we're looking at the frameworks or the operation of the Internal Market Act, which we know has built into it all sorts of opportunities for executive action to change the existing provisions, there are multiple points at which you know, concerns arise about the transparency and scrutiny opportunities.
That's a very helpful answer. I think in particular, we might be interested about that issue about the closed process and to what extent there's any transparency on those issues from the Office of the Internal Market. Could you just finish by saying a bit about dispute resolutions? I mentioned that in relation to my first question to Professor Wetherill.
Well, I mean, we're looking across the piece at how we've got this twin track approach to managing the internal market through the common frameworks, through the Internal Market Act. We don't yet fully know how this will play out in terms of the balance between those two, that twin track approach, whether the common frameworks will come to be the general approach that is taken, and we have the Internal Market Act as a fallback. Within the common frameworks, and they don't all follow the same model, but there are built-in processes there for dispute resolution, but they don't necessarily follow the same as a dispute resolution. But you know, there is more of a co-owned, cooperative approach to creating those structures that don't yet exist. And we know that there are moves through the Intergovernmental Relations Review to try and improve and upgrade what happens generally. Dispute resolution, we still don't fully know how the Internal Market Act will be enforced and applied. We know that the OIM doesn't have enforcement abilities. A lot of this is going to be dependent on local regulatory authorities, depending whether or not to prosecute traders for breaching local regulations. That seems to be the thrust of it. So these things might end up before courts and bring in matters of potential constitutional principle that end up there, you know, not being approached as a constitutional issue, but they may take us before the courts in a way that, you know, we don't know where those cases are going to end up. We don't know how far up the judicial hierarchy we're going to go. We don't know what potential consequences they might have for devolution. We know if we look at recent years, the cases that have been brought before the Supreme Court on devolution issues, you know, these have not been particularly accommodating to the claims of devolved governments and devolved parliaments in terms of the readings that they've given to devolved competence. And I think there's concerns around the potential of these things ending up before the courts.
Thanks very much.
Thank you. Ms. Mintel.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, panel, and thank you for your submissions. I'd like to follow on these questions and question around the ability of the Scottish Government to drive effective policy reform and the ability of the Scottish Parliament to legislate effectively. I'm interested, we've been talking about the UK Internal Market Act and devolution. I'm interested to get your thoughts on the Subsidy Control Bill that's currently going through Parliament just now, and how you think that could be impacted by the current situation. Professor Hunt, you're on screen just now. Can you respond to that question?
If we move to this being a piece of Westminster legislation, that this is, you know, an approach that is taken that is not the collaborative output of the four governments, and we know that that was not the favoured approach, and that was of the devolved parliaments and governments. I think, can I give way to others that might have more
Absolutely.
Detailed knowledge of the Subsidy Control Bill?
Professor Wetherill or Nicola McEwen? Professor McEwen?
I don't have particular expertise on the contents of the bill, but what I would say is that clearly subsidy control was reserved within the Internal Market Act, and so it's not going to be the case where the consent of the Scottish Parliament is required. But it's one example of where reserved policy, newly deserved policy, will have an effect on the responsibilities of the Scottish Parliament. And one of the downsides of the frameworks process, there's lots to benefit and applaud in the frameworks process and the collaborative nature of it. One of the weaknesses of it, it seems to me, is that it's solely focused on areas where EU law or retained EU law intersects with devolved competence. So it's all about devolved matters. There isn't scope within that for engagement and collaboration on those areas of reserved policy that impact upon devolved responsibilities. But there is potential for the broader intergovernmental process to allow for that kind of engagement. So you talked earlier about there being a twin track of internal market legislation and the frameworks process. I would say there's a triple track, and the third one being the IGR review. Now, these processes within UK government in particular have been completely detached from each other, with very different motivations, it seems to be, different dynamics at play, different characteristics, but they all connect. And the IGR review that has been going on since March 2018 looks like it might be coming to some sort of conclusion, probably not unlike the interim report that we saw earlier in the year. And that does provide potentially scope for the Scottish Government, at least, to try to influence these types of processes in reserved policy areas, whether it's around subsidy control or trade or external relations or other areas that have an effect on devolved competence. The challenge for you is to make sure that there is parliamentary engagement in the Scottish Government's positions on these. Scottish Government, I think, in line with the agreement reached with the Parliament, has been good at reporting on its activities in the IGR space. Where there might be scope for development is enhancing the role of Parliament in shaping the Scottish Government's approach to IGR, not just in hearing about it afterwards.
Thank you, Professor McHugh. Can I just give you a specific question on your joint submission? Section 3.2, policy divergence can, however, produce effects that may be regarded as adverse. Divergence in public services generates distinctive rights and entitlements within the same country, which some may consider unfair. I wonder if you can expand a bit on that, because clearly that's a lot of where our devolved parliaments are legislating. Thank you.
So that's not specific to the Internal Market Act at all. This is just a general, it was in response to your general question about policy divergence.
Yes.
I might answer with a discussion I often have with my students, where I ask the fairness question to the students in the room, whether it's fair if, when they're from the same country as in the United Kingdom, some of them are paying £9,000 a year and some of them are not. And that's an example, an illustrative example of policy divergence, which is perfectly legitimate in terms of the system of multi-level government that we have. It's within the competence of the different institutions to make their own choices on public policies. But what it would mean is, and what it does mean, is that citizens of the same country have different rights and different entitlements and different obligations. That's simply a feature of multi-level government, in as much as that system is accepted by everybody, then presumably those divergences are accepted as well. But it is one of the effects of it, and people may have different views as to how far they're willing to tolerate those divergences.
Right. Thank you very much. And Professor Weatherall, my initial question about the subsidy control bill. If you have any thoughts on that?
No.
No. Well, in that case, may I throw back your final question that you gave in your submission? What sort of a United Kingdom is this? I'd like to hear your thoughts on that.
Yeah, I know. It's a rather silly throwaway remark, so I probably should apologise for it. But, I mean, all I was trying to do there was to bring out as vividly as I can that the arrangements for the United Kingdom Internal Market Act are idiosyncratic, as I think Joe said. They're also asymmetric, and they bring about very different frictions and tensions, albeit that they bring about a lot of frictions and tensions. And I think the important point is, if your political preference is to have a United Kingdom which is as much as possible governed according to Westminster's preferences, with minimal tolerance for divergence within the constituent elements of the United Kingdom, then under the arrangements of the United Kingdom Internal Market Act plus the protocol, in Northern Ireland, you're really very distressed, because the whole point of the protocol plus the UK Internal Market Act is to place Northern Ireland in terms of the market for goods in a regulatory jurisdiction, which is not set from London, but rather is set by the European Union. By contrast, if your preference is for a United Kingdom which is, as far as possible, dominated by the preferences of Westminster, then in Scotland and Wales, you're really rather cheerful, because what the United Kingdom Internal Market Act does is, in significant respects, to undermine, in substance, if not in form, the devolution settlement, which has been in place for several decades now, because the result of the United Kingdom Internal Market Act is that English producers do not need to comply with stricter Scottish or Welsh rules, insofar as those stricter Scottish or Welsh rules exclude them from Scottish and Welsh markets, unless the very limited range of justifications envisaged by the United Kingdom Internal Market Act apply. So you've got disappointment amongst some people in Northern Ireland, disappointment among some people in Scotland and Wales, but the people who are disappointed are very different in their motivations and their attitudes to the nature of the United Kingdom. And, you know, my admittedly rather silly throwaway observation question, what kind of United Kingdom it is, but my answer is it's a really fragile one. It's one which is being threatened by anxieties, dissent, but different kinds of anxieties and dissent, whether one is in Northern Ireland on the one hand and in Scotland or Wales on the other hand. But this is, in a sense, it's just about trade, it's just about the internal market, but it's about a lot more than that, as all internal markets are, because any choice about how to design an internal market spills over into political questions about how far to pursue unimpeded trade at the expense of the preservation of local regulatory autonomy. That's my rather long answer to the rather short question I finished my evidence with.
Thank you very much, Professor Wetherill.
Thank you. Can I move to questions from Mr. Golden, please?
Thank you, Convener. Clearly, the Internal Market Act applies equally. But this also brings up some questions in terms of what existing legislation was in place that brings new legislation in the scope of the Internal Market Act. So, for example, deposit return scheme, the legislation was through in advance, and therefore it should be able to be implemented without respect to the Internal Market Act. But in England and Wales, deposit return would need to be implemented with cognizance taken of the Internal Market Act, which could lead to detrimental implications for England in that case, and advantages certainly from a business point of view for Scotland. So I think in this example and many others, clearly one solution is
integration of common frameworks to overlay the Internal Market Act. But where that fails, or where future governments of any of the administration seek to dispute those common frameworks, I wonder for your thoughts, perhaps, Professor Weatherall, on what specific dispute resolution mechanisms can be put in place in advance to try and ensure that we comply with existing legislation and allow any of the devolved administrations to improve regulations or make legislative changes as they see fit.
Yeah, if you look to the European Union for assistance, and you really should, because the European Union has had the job of creating, maintaining, sustaining an internal market for a long time now, what you find in the European Union is that the problems which arise because of the potential adoption of rules, regulations, technical standards, which might differ state by state and cause obstacles to interstate trade, are managed through a process whereby a state that proposes to introduce a new technical regulation might impede trade must notify it to the Commission in advance of bringing it into force, and there's a defined standstill period within which the regulation must not be brought into force, pending its examination by the Commission, with the opportunity for views to be put forward by other member states, so that an assessment can be made of whether the regulation should be treated as justified or not. It's not justified, it shouldn't be introduced. If it is justified, it might provoke the political impetus towards harmonising rules, with the consequence that the rule will not be introduced until it's been reviewed in advance, and any harm that might arise will ideally have been prevented rather than occurred. All that management system is missing from the UK Internal Market Act. The UK Internal Market Act assumes that a constituent element of the UK may introduce a rule and then find it challenged one way or another as an impediment to trade within the United Kingdom. And eventually, possibly years later, maybe even decades later, the matter will come before a court, which will have to apply the Internal Market Act and decide whether or not the rule is compatible with it. And there will have been damage done to the market in the intervening period. So my suggestion for reforming the, several suggestions for reforming the UK Internal Market Act, but on the particular point that you raised, uncertainty about what might happen, the system needs a better, firmer management system. Most of all, there should be a pre-notification system so that proposed new regulations which might impede trade within the United Kingdom can be considered, can be assessed for their worth in advance of their introduction.
Thank you, Professor Weatherall. That's very helpful. Would Professor Jo Hunt like to come in on that?
Yeah, absolutely. Just to reflect again on the fact that, you know, in the choices that were made with the introduction of the Internal Market Act, there were already in place these processes and these procedures. As Stephen says, you know, the Technical Specifications Directive, that has been in place and that has had, that has applied across the UK, and regulations made in Wales, made in Scotland, made in Northern Ireland, those notifications were made. That was part of the, you know, the policy-making process. So it's not just that they're missing, it's that these things are being removed, things that were already part of the policy process, and we knew how these things worked and had an appreciation of them, that, you know, we're now replacing that ex ante approach that, you know, that led to a greater degree of certainty about how these regulations would then be applicable, that, you know, we're moving from that and replacing it with, as Stephen said, you know, an incredibly uncertain regime that we're still trying to work out the dimensions of and the various ways that the different elements interrelate.
Thank you. And Professor McEwen, do you have any comments or thoughts?
The couple of things. So there is a glimmer of hope in the frameworks process, in that frameworks, common frameworks, are supposed to establish ways of working that should allow for that kind of collaboration. But a lot of that requires political will, which may or may not be present. And it is limited to the areas that are addressed within the sort of narrowly defined frameworks themselves. So that won't capture the new regulations, the areas that don't connect to frameworks. The other thing I wanted to comment on, you mentioned, you're quite right, of course, that the Internal Market Act applies to all of the legislatures within all of the laws made amongst the UK's different legislatures. So it applies to UK laws too, as much as to devolved ones. But of course, the difference is that there is an asymmetry here built into the legislation itself, which made the UK Internal Market Act a protected act within the devolution statutes. So there is nothing that you and your colleagues could do about it in terms of your lawmaking capacities to make any amendments here. The Westminster Parliament is not constrained in the same way. So if in principle, in theory, it was found that this was a frustration in terms of the UK government being able to pursue and fulfil its policy objectives, then it could change it in a way that you cannot. And so yes, it applies equally, and yes, it will create some challenges actually for DEFRA in particular, perhaps in doing things in the way that they want to do it, but the effects in the end are not the same because of the asymmetries built into the legislation.
Thank you, convener. Thank you, panel.
Thank you. Can I invite Mr. Cameron?
Yes, thank you very much. My first question is to Professor Hunt and Professor McEwen in relation to something that you say in your submission about common frameworks. And you say that depending on their scope and content, common framework agreements could commit the Scottish Government to shared or minimal standards and rules, potentially limiting the scope for action of the Scottish Parliament. And that's at paragraph 1.10 of your submission. Can I just explore that? What do you mean by that? And I noted one of you referring to downsides to common frameworks, I think it's Professor McEwen. What do you mean by limiting the scope of action for Parliament? Perhaps Professor McEwen, followed by Professor Hunt.
What I mean by that is that if there is agreement within the common frameworks process to maintain certain standards or to do things uniformly or to whatever it is that they agree to do, if that agreement is to do things in the same way across the UK so as to have a UK-wide system, then in effect, this is signing up to do things as if it applied to the UK as a whole in an area of devolved competence. So that agreement would have the effect of minimising the potential for the Scottish Parliament to do something differently, should it choose to do so. It wouldn't have a legal constraint. The Parliament would still have the autonomy to do what it wanted to do, but then it would detach itself from the framework. So, I mean, the good thing about the frameworks process is that it is a collaborative process. It is intergovernmental, so it is doing things by consent. Now, sometimes that might be consent to do things in the same way. Sometimes it might be consent to do things differently and, you know, potentially then having a connection with the exemptions from the UK Internal Market Act as well. So I think that's what we were trying to get across there. Does that clarify?
Yes, it does. I wonder if I could ask Professor Hunt the same question, and also if you could comment on, particularly given where you are, how the Welsh Parliament has dealt with common frameworks in your experience. And I ask that question given that in the last Parliament I sat on the Health Committee and we consult or scrutinise the common framework in terms of food hygiene and labelling. And we heard evidence from the Scottish Government, we heard evidence from stakeholders. And as a process, initially, I think we're probably the first committee of this Parliament to do that. But as a process, it seemed to work relatively well. And I just wonder if you have any sort of Welsh view, if I could put it like that, in terms of how it's working.
I mean, I just reiterate, you know, we have the ongoing issue with capacity issues within our own institute, within our own Parliament in Wales, and there is an agreement that has recently been made between Plaid Cymru and the Labour government to work together, and one of the commitments is to increase the size of the Parliament to seek to better be able to manage these matters. I mean, scrutiny and transparency of the common frameworks, it's, you know, as we said before, it's not going to be a one-shot process. It's going to need to be an ongoing engagement and an ongoing accountability of the decisions that are being made under those frameworks back to Parliament. And as Nicola has just sort of forcefully outlined there, you know, we've got this ongoing move of powers to the executives throughout this process. The whole Brexit process has been one of strengthening the role of the executives across the United Kingdom, and that need to rebalance this through, you know, building in mechanisms for engagement by the parliaments. And as a number of suggestions have been made to you around interparliamentary activity, and as you say, we have the interparliamentary forum. So really seeking to develop those routes.
Can I ask all of you, gazing into the crystal ball, because I think we all accept that we're at a very early stage here, but looking to the future, do you foresee the what will actually happen in practice is common frameworks being used in the vast majority of cases and the Internal Market Act becoming a kind of fallback if that doesn't work, or do you foresee something different happening? If you're, any of you are able to answer that question, perhaps Professor Wetherill might start.
I can't have any kind of crystal ball here. I can see the political incentives in Scotland and Wales to advance rules which are likely to be undermined by the UK Internal Market Act, because it demonstrates, which might be politically useful in Edinburgh and Cardiff, the weaknesses of being tied to this government in London. I can see incentives, on the other hand, for this government in London to use the common frameworks process very sparingly in order to use the market access principles as a way to promote a more deregulatory United Kingdom than one might have expected to be in place as a result of the devolution settlement. But I do feel I'm in some danger of going beyond my brief, going beyond the reasons why you've invited me here this morning. This is very much political speculation, albeit on the basis of the legal structure which is put in place for the UK Internal Market Act.
Professor McKeown?
Academics generally don't like looking into crystal balls, but I'll give it a go. The alternative to the legalistic and centralising approach of the UK Internal Market Act is an intergovernmental one. And that has some challenges for parliamentary scrutiny, of course, but it is the most sort of potentially devolution-friendly approach to managing the internal market, to managing the economic union. Whether it actually works like that through the frameworks process, I have some doubts, and partly because the frameworks are quite narrowly defined, and as time moves on, we would expect to see more regulations that don't connect as easily to the frameworks and fall within the scope of the frameworks. There could be an intergovernmental process used alongside that to capture those other areas. That would be the other alternative. That's this kind of system that we see in many other countries that are similarly trying to manage divergence and autonomy and economic union. This is a challenge for every multi-level system. I just don't see that being the path ahead within the current political context. We haven't yet seen evidence of the political will to make that kind of system happen very, very effectively. And indeed, over the last few years, we've seen a lot of dysfunction in intergovernmental relations. So it's very difficult from this vantage point to see that changing within the near future anyway. So it would require an awful lot of political will and a change of political culture for that to be the path ahead. But having said that, I think it is the path that helps to stabilise this, if it is to be stabilised at all, because there's no question in my mind that the approach taken in the UK Internal Market Act has had a destabilising effect on the system of devolution and on the UK's territorial constitution.
And Professor Hunt?
I think my reading of the Internal Market Act and the its introduction is very much it was it was an insurance policy in terms of what might be needed to manage international trade negotiations that should the potential for policy divergence across the UK that might exist under the common frameworks, if that were to stand in the way of international trade agreements, that the Internal Market Act provides the tools, also other tools that would have achieved the same purpose, but that it very clearly provides that ability for international trade agreements that the UK can negotiate on the basis of definitely Great Britain. So a lot of this depends on where we are with international trade agreements, on the cut across, the read across of those agreements, across these governance tools, and we know the significance and the importance of, from a devolved perspective, of having proper engagement in those processes of negotiating those agreements, so that it does feel like a collaborative approach rather than, again, something imposed from the centre. So I think it depends a lot on how that plays out.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Mr. Ruskell.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I think, actually, in many of the answers, you've already touched on some of the questions I was going to ask around interparliamentary scrutiny. I was wondering if there was anything more that our panellists would like to add on that. I mean, we did have a submission, I think, from the Institute of Government, which was suggesting the idea of policy-specific chairs forums to mirror interministerial groups. And I wondered if that was something which could work perhaps around circular economy or other areas where there are frameworks. So I don't know if the panellists have got any more thoughts on what that sort of architecture of scrutiny looks like. Professor Hunt or Professor McEwen? No? Okay. I'll move on then. So the other point I think that's made quite strongly in your submissions is around this potential chilling effect on the development of innovation, regulatory and innovation, new policies coming forward. I'm just wondering if there's any evidence of that coming through already. There's obviously some policies that are already in train in the Scottish Parliament this week. We've just dealt with single-use plastic regulations that have come to committee for the first time. But is there any sense of kind of where this is stifling policy development at this point? Can I go to Professor Weatherall to start?
thematic understanding of this. I have in front of me a cutting from The Guardian a couple of weeks ago, which is entitled "Kicking the Can Down the Road, New Delay Likely for Deposits Plan." And it tells me that Scottish ministers are accused of giving in to lobbying from retailers and industry. And certainly a deposit and return system, which would be introduced for good environmental reasons, would be vulnerable to challenge for its effect on goods originating in other parts of the United Kingdom under the UK Internal Market Act. So that might be an area in which one would look to find empirical evidence for a chilling effect of the UK Internal Market Act on Scottish regulatory activity. But I only have a cutting from The Guardian, and The Guardian, you know, isn't always accurate. So I have no more detail or inside information on that issue than that.
Yeah. Professor McKeown?
I mean, I think it's very difficult for us from the outside to identify a chilling effect, because inevitably that implies that things are not coming forward that might otherwise be. So I think certainly in your scrutiny of ministers, it would be really good to probe that. I noticed the First Minister, was it last week or the week before, raised some concerns about the changes to minimum unit pricing having some sort of constraint in effect from the Internal Market Act. Minimum unit pricing would be subject to the non-discrimination elements of the Act rather than the mutual recognition elements as a point of sale issue, but it would still potentially be affected by it. So it may be that just there's quite a lot of uncertainty, it seems to me, about the effect of the Act that might in itself be introducing some delays in the policymaking process, if not putting things into a long-term chill. But it's, from the outside, it's very difficult for us to identify that. I did want to come in actually on your previous question around scrutiny. I think that IFG recommendation is a good one in terms of shadowing interministerial groups, but potentially it would be an awful lot of work, and it's not clear how transparent the interministerial forums will be in terms of what they are doing and what types of things they are discussing and how substantive that is. But I think that's certainly potentially something that could aid parliamentary scrutiny, is to match that and shadow that with your colleagues in other legislatures. One thing that might be worth probing a bit more is consent. So consent, as we understand it in terms of SUL, obviously has a very clear role for the devolved legislatures, but consent as it's written into the processes around the Internal Market Act and potentially around common frameworks does not have a clear parliamentary role. So just perhaps doing an inquiry into not just SUL consent and legislative consent, but consent in general and the role of parliaments in being part of any consenting process that is established by Internal Market and similar processes and legislation, I think could add value and could ensure that there is a role for Parliament in all of these processes.
Mm-hmm. And if Professor Hunt wants to come back in.
Reflecting on the suggestion that there may be a chilling effect that is applied, and as has been mentioned already, we don't necessarily know what's not been happening. I was taking a look at the document that Welsh Gov, the Labour government and Plaid Cymru have recently issued, which sets out a sort of a plan of proposed policy, policy commitments over the next few years and working together. And I was looking through that to see whether any of these could potentially be caught by the Internal Market Act. And I mean, there is the sort of talk of a community food strategy encouraging the production and supply of locally sourced food in Wales. Now, that might be achievable under a public procurement common framework. We don't know whether, you know, I don't know the terms of that framework, and whether it would be, whether it would survive under that framework, or whether it would be subject to the non-discrimination principle. And we know that there are various sort of exemptions that are available for non-discrimination, but this is sort of suggestive of sort of falling under, you know, potential discrimination. We don't know how that justification is going to be interpreted in terms of, you know, necessary means of meeting a legitimate aim, and, you know, who's going to be interpreting that that justification. So, I mean, if it is having a chilling effect, it's not surprising because of just the degree of uncertainty that's at play throughout this.
Yeah. And just a final question. It's around, I guess, kind of how we've moved away from EU policy development processes. I was struck with the REACH chemicals regulations, how involved different stakeholders were, from industry to unions to environmental NGOs. How do you see that kind of shift now? Because obviously we're out of Europe. There's perhaps a different policy development process. Which voices do you think are going to be heard? Where do those voices come in, and how should parliaments actually engage with those stakeholders? Could we go back to Professor Weatherall, maybe, start?
Yeah, I don't think I have anything well-informed to say about that. A lot will depend on the transparency of the processes, the extent to which the opportunities for input are structured. And there's no particular reason why the UK would follow the EU's example, although it might choose to do so. But it, part of things could look very different very quickly.
Okay. Professor McKeown?
I don't have anything in particular to add. I mean, you have lots of experience with stakeholder engagement, and the Parliament has a very strong track record in ensuring that it's not just the best resourced stakeholders that have an opportunity to engage. So more of the same. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And Professor Hunt?
Yeah. And yet again, you know, the European Union had a very well-developed, a very sort of systematic approach to stakeholder engagement, a very transparent approach that in some ways is very much, you know, a model to be followed, and one that perhaps we don't yet see here.
Okay.
Thank you. Very briefly, and Ms. Boyack.
Thanks very much, Convener. I appreciate that. It was just to follow up the question that Mark Ruskell asked, where you mentioned the procurement process potentially being impacted, because in the evidence we've got, you've talked about whereas regulations affecting the production or sale of goods are subject to market access principles, regulations affecting the use of goods are not. So would that not mean that procurement or planning would not be covered by market access principles, because that isn't impacting on whether a product is made in a certain way, but how products are actually used through government systems? Could you just draw a differential there that I think is quite important to have on the record? Thank you. I just wanted to check I'd understood that the representations we've had, if you wanted to just comment on it a bit further.
We make that distinction within the evidence that we gave, and it's recognising a distinction in the approach that the UK has taken from the one that EU law applies. And it, as Stephen referenced, you know, the EU has got 70-odd years of experience of working out how these rules operate, and closed categories of determining the sorts of obstacles to trade, that it came very clear that, you know, a selling arrangement, rules on sale, rules on product regulation, that these didn't cover everything, and that there were things that sort of fell outside of those, such as product use. And the EU regime has evolved to adopt and, you know, adapt to doing to accommodate that wider range of measures. Now, we don't know, because of we haven't yet seen this legislation in action, how product use is being defined, whether it is if there's been explicit statement to say that it's it falls outside, then again, that's a difference from the EU regime. So there were cases that under EU law that cover situations where something may be legitimately sold, but that it cannot be lawfully used. And so it's those sorts of issues that we were addressing in the evidence. And how these play into issues of public procurement, as I said, you know, we have a framework there, and we don't yet know what that cut across will be between that framework and the Internal Market Act.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you. Can I ask just two things of rolling into one question? We're up against time now. So it's in relation to the position that we've come from, where the Internal Market Act didn't receive consent from the Scottish Parliament, and there is a judicial review, which I believe is still ongoing in terms of Wales. So how precarious is all of this, depending on the outcome of that court case? And in terms of, we talked a lot about the Inter-Parliamentary Forum and ways of scrutinising, but in effect, my understanding is that we have the power to scrutinise Scottish Government ministers' actions on these areas. But as soon as executive power is used in a devolved area, we have no ability to call a UK government minister to a scrutinising committee of the Parliament. So do you think that the scrutiny and transparency should be formalised, maybe with a change in law regarding these areas? How do you see, because even the Inter-Parliamentary Forum is not a formal arrangement of the parliaments as yet. So how could that be firmed up to ensure that there is absolute certainty that the devolved nations can scrutinise on these areas? I've got Professor Hunt, you're on my screen at the moment. I'll go to you first.
Well, we know that the judicial review challenge from the Welsh Government will be from the Council General. I think it's being heard in January. And I've mentioned earlier, in terms of what we might find from that judgment, we've had experience recently of readings from the courts of devolved competence that are perhaps quite unexpectedly narrow. And we saw sort of the reach of that, Westminster Parliament's unqualified power to legislate, you know, in the UNCRC reference, for example. So we've, again, no crystal ball. I don't necessarily see that action as being something that an awful lot of reliance should be placed on, in terms of improving how this act plays out for the devolved legislatures.
Thank you.
And then the second question.
It was really about how if the situation arises that there's an executive decision used that bypasses the frameworks and the devolved nations, what advice can you give to us as a scrutinising committee of the Parliament to how do we do that, or do formal arrangements need to be brought in place that would allow us then to scrutinise the UK government's decisions in these matters?
I mean, the struggle there, of course, is, our system of devolution is one that most generally, has not been one that has progressed through formalised, regularised processes that have very little underpinnings of any sort of statutory nature. So, there's a certain amount of sort of working against the grain in getting those things established. And the question would be, what would be the interest in the UK government of opening these things up to those sorts of formal processes? So, I mean, whilst absolutely, there is every reason why that sort of mechanism for accountability should be sought, you can imagine that there will be barriers along the way to getting that built in.
Professor McEwen?
in place.
Sorry, can you start again? You missed the start of that. Sorry. Okay. Thanks.
There is already a formal agreement in place whereby you have the entitlement to be informed of the Scottish Government's participation in intergovernmental discussions and agreements. And the executive powers within the legislation would formally require some sort of consultation process to take place at the ministerial level. So one option open to you would be to ensure that within that Scottish Government, Scottish Parliament relationship, there is a formal process in place for you to have a role to play, whatever that may be. So in terms of your responsibilities as a legislature, it is to hold the Scottish Government to account, but that doesn't prevent you from scrutinising the actions of other administrations where they have an effect on your own responsibilities. One point I was going to mention earlier, we talked a little bit about the Office of the Internal Market and its function in terms of scrutinising the implementation of the Act and of the market access principles, but nobody, to my knowledge, is tasked with scrutinising the impact of the Act on devolution and on regulatory autonomy. And that might be something that you, perhaps in collaboration with colleagues in other legislatures, perhaps in collaboration with the academic community, might want to take on board as well, because I think that's also the other important dimension to all of this.
Professor Wetherill?
That is more helpful than anything I could say.
Okay, on that note, I shall bring the session to an end. Can I thank you all for your attendance this morning and also for your submissions to the committee, which were very helpful. And that concludes our agenda item, and I will now close the meeting this morning.